All right, welcome to TK's Two Cents. We are live today, just like every Tuesday and Thursday at 12 p.m. Eastern Time. I take a couple of tweets and I riff on it, provide a little context for you. And today I'm going to talk about pain and why your pain is the reason they'll remember your name. If you get through it, if you get through it. So let's take a look at tweet number one. If you have challenges that no one else has faced, then you can have a testimony no one else can replace. You know, I come from the church, and in the church culture, the word testimony refers to a statement or a declaration about something powerful that God has done for or through you. And I believe that we all have a unique testimony. And when it feels like you are going through trials that no one else can understand, that's only because you have a testimony that no one else can be able to replace. No one else can be a substitute for it. Now, I have two fundamental beliefs about problems and purpose. The first belief is that the overwhelming majority of things that we go through as human beings have already been gone through by other people, that there's really nothing new under the sun. If you have some kind of problem, like a boss that doesn't trust you or respect you, a spouse or a significant other who, you know, maybe has betrayed you or that you have a difficult time getting along with, a customer that's on your back all the time, a parent, a roommate that, you know, you're having beef with, whatever it is, you're scared of the political climate of the world, whatever it is, there are thousands of people that have gone before you and have wrestled with similar experiences, and they have documented their ideas and their insights. And you can take those ideas and insights and you can transform them into tools that can be used to help you alleviate your own problems. And that's one of the beautiful things about life. You know, we think our problems are the first time in history that a human being has ever experienced difficulty. And then you start to talk to other people, you start to read, you start to listen to podcasts, you start to get out there and engage people, and you start to realize, oh, okay, this has all been worked out before. And for the most part, I don't have to reinvent the wheel when it comes to dealing with life's challenges. But there's a second fundamental belief. And that second fundamental belief is that every human being is an unrepeatable phenomenon, that you are here for a brief time on this earth, and you have the potential to impact the world in a way that no one will be able to do. Once you're over, there won't be a sequel to you. There may be a remix. There may be somebody who comes, you know, after you and uses your life as an influence to mix up with their other influences, and they can remix the things you've said and done, but there won't be a sequel to you. You're an unrepeatable phenomenon. And what that means is that even though the things you go through, other people will have wrestled with similar problems, there's going to be some aspect of your challenges that will be unique. Something about the tone of your problem, the color of your problem, the ambiance of your problem, whatever it may be, that will make you feel fundamentally alone. You'll talk to people about it and your friends will say, I understand, but you'll know that no one carries the weight of that burden quite like you. And when those moments happen, it can be tempting to think that you are at a disadvantage. But the reality is that unique burden is a gift, because that is the very thing that gives you the opportunity for significance. What do I mean by significance? I don't mean fame. I don't mean a whole lot of money. I mean living your life with a sense that there is something that you can do that's irreplaceable. That they can't just, you know, put somebody else in a uniform and, you know, put a name tag on them and have them do your job and it can be done in the same way. They can't replace you with a robot. There's something about you that is irreplaceable. And that significance comes from the uniqueness of your problems. Because when you have a challenge that no one else has gone through, no one else can understand, that means when you do the work of figuring out how to cope with that challenge, how to create around that challenge, how to undermine the conditions that perpetuate that challenge, how to transform that challenge, that perceived disadvantage, into an advantage. When you do that hard work and figure it out, that means you're going to be able to offer the world solutions, creative insights, ideas that no one else will be able to provide because they don't understand the inner working of the problem that made those awesome solutions possible. So my encouragement to you is don't resent your unique problems, because when you resent your unique problems, you resist the unique wisdom that those problems provide. Every unique problem that you face has within it a unique kernel of wisdom that you can unearth, that you can extract, and then you can be able to give that back to the world and say, hey, y'all, this is me. And when you leave this earth, you can leave with the impact, you can leave with the confidence that you allowed the world to feel the unique weight of who you are, that your impact has been felt, and no one else can come along and do it quite like you. But that doesn't mean that you're born with some default indispensability. You have to manufacture the meaning, in a sense, by following up on your interests, by acquiring and developing new skills and combining those things in a way that solves problems for others and creates value for others. So this isn't me giving you a participation trophy or patting you on the head or patting you on the back and saying, hey, you're awesome, just go through life feeling awesome. No, it's you have an opportunity. And everything that gets in your way, everything that tempts you to feel down on your life is part of that opportunity, because that's the thing which, when you figure out, is going to be a part of your legacy. Your pain, if you can make it through it, will be the reason why they remember your name. Let's go to tweet number two, because we're gonna continue on this theme of pain. Sometimes we see pain as a reason to stop creating, but what if your pain was a reason to start? What if your pain was a reason to start? You know, we often confuse being inspired with feeling amazing, feeling awesome. But some of the most meaningful and beautiful and valuable and powerful works of art have been the direct result of people going through pain. How did we get Viktor Frankl's Man's Search for Meaning if it wasn't for the suffering that he went through? Most of those love songs you listen to come from pain. I remember watching a biopic about this songwriter who had the prettiest lyrics, and there was a reviewer that said, you know, his love songs have the prettiest lyrics, but he's going to be a much better writer once he gets his heart broken. And when that happened, that writer began to flourish, because there's something about the pain that forces you to dig deep and really make contact with your humanity. So I want to make the case for why, if you're experiencing pain, that's not a reason to give up on the creative process. That's not a reason to abandon it. That's a reason to embrace it, because this is what the creative process is for. So here's the case. Creativity is a form of catharsis. There are things that simply cannot be said in a direct, explicit, meticulous, and precise way. And there are things that creative labor allows you to release in an indirect, playful, or imaginative way. You know, there was a dancer who performed this routine, and someone in the audience asked, you know, after the performance, they said, what was the meaning of your dance? And the dancer said, if I could tell you the meaning, there would not have been a need for me to dance the meaning. There are some things that can only be expressed through a dance, through doodling, through playing an instrument, composing a song, playing a game, or channeling that emotion into sport, channeling it into a creative project, or whatever it may be. Creativity is a form of catharsis. And so many times when we experience pain, we treat talking it out, usually venting to a friend, as if that's the optimal way to release that pain. But when you engage in creative labor, you take away all of those rules, and you are allowed to be imaginative and playful in ways that are indirect. And that can allow you to look at your pain from an unconventional vantage point, and that can contribute massively to the healing process. The second thing is that creativity connects you with other people. James Baldwin said, you experience pain and you think you're alone in the world, but then you begin to read and you realize that your pain is what connects you with all of humanity. What Baldwin said of reading, I believe, is also true of creating. Because when you create, you are taking your thoughts and your feelings and you are transforming them into artifacts. And then those artifacts can become a bridge across which other people can connect to you. Other people can relate to you. And one of the most dangerous things about being in a place of pain is that we can feel so isolated and disconnected from the world. And when you create, it connects you to the world, because you are never more human than when you create. Now, one quick word about creativity. Whenever I say creativity, and I'm even guilty of it here in the examples I gave, because I talked about writing music or I talked about dancing, but creativity isn't limited to the arts. There's more to creativity than painting, than drawing, than playing an instrument, than doing improvisational theater. Creativity is any imaginative or playful activity that allows you to explore and express your human authenticity. Anything that you do can be creative. I just met someone the other week who pours his heart and soul into making drinks as an expression of creativity. And it makes him come alive as much as I've seen anybody come alive by DJing music. There are people that express that creativity through cooking, through child rearing, through whatever it may be. But you know, by consulting your own curiosity, what mode of creativity is best for you. The important thing is to practice some aspect of it in the way that resonates with your personality and your style, and not limit yourself by saying, I'm only creative if I'm doing things that are similar to the artists that I know. None of that stuff matters. What matters is that you are exploring and expressing your authentic self in a way that is imaginative, in a way that is playful, in a way that is unconventional, in a way that engages the unfamiliar and allows you to connect with yourself at a deeper level and connect with others. And that can help you with your healing process. When you experience unique pain, embrace it as a gift, because that's what gives you unique purpose. Translate that experience of pain into creative action. And your pain, if you get through it, if you don't use it as a basis for giving up, will be the reason they say, yeah, I remember that person. They really inspired me. Not because their life was boring and perfect, but because their life was painful and challenging. And they modeled for me what it means to be a dignified and creative human being in the midst of hardship. That's 2 cents for today. I'll see y'all next week, Tuesday, 12 p.m. Eastern Time. Peace.